is investing in grandchildren and younger generations. And obviously we're doing a panel because we have a wealth of knowledge between our two canvases. So we have Jim and Cheryl Taylor here down at the end, Miss Sarah Poff and Miss Mary Moss. I'm going to share some of their information, and all of our panelists have been investing in the younger generation in our churches for years, and also in the younger generations of their own family with grandchildren and great-grandchildren, so they have a lot to share with us. Okay. So we'll just jump right in. How do any of our panelists who want to answer, how do you find time to be part of your grandchildren or the young people's lives in your life, as well as take care of your responsibilities and your own interests?
Grandkids are most of the time we spend. We watch some of our grandkids 3 days a week as needed, which is Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday as needed. And they're all three going to be in school this year. So those youngest ones start in grade school. But so we've got Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday responsibility when they need it, when they're needing someone to watch them. And so, like, we did have them Sunday night through Monday because Mom and Dad were out of town. Dad's on a business trip in Colorado, and Mom went with him. So we watched the kids for part of that time, and then another grandparent's watching them Tuesday, Monday night, Tuesday night, and then we get them
back tomorrow night.
So, but when school starts up, then we have a responsibility of taking these kids to school or picking them up from school. And we live in the south end of Blue Springs, and they live in the north end of Blue Springs, so obviously their schools are in the north end of town. We have to drive up the north end of town to get them. So, that's a little ways, but it's not terribly far. So it's just part of what you don't have to do. So that's just built into our schedule. So one of the two of us, figures that out, who we got to pick up where, when, and whatever. Sometimes, so this schedule changes often. So it takes good communication with Mom and Dad as to what days we got to be sure to pick them up and what days we don't have to pick them up. And then my other two grandkids live in Lee Summit. Mom doesn't work, and we don't have to mess with them a whole lot as far as that. But you gotta work at trying to communicate with them a little bit differently than the others who know us real well. So.
You want to go ahead? Well, since I'm.
Yeah, go ahead.
Grandparent of many.
Yes. Why don't you share how many or.
I will.
Okay.
I have two generations of grandkids, actually, because I have grandchildren who are aged 19 to 34, and I have great-grandchildren. In fact, I have seven now, and they are age 10 down to one that's almost here. So I am busting my buttons, as always. And I worked until just about 3 years ago, and when I retired, then I loved the time that I was able to share, and I did share with my older grandkids when I was working. I made time because I wanted to be with them, and we went places. I don't give them presents much. We just do stuff, and I've always been very close to all of my grandchildren and thankful for that. As they've grown up, it's a little harder to keep in touch, but I do. I make dates with them, and especially the older ones, because I don't want to lose touch with them. So that's my story.
Any other?
And I have two grandchildren, a 1-year-old and a 3-year-old. And I was still working when the first one came, teaching school, and I do a lot of volunteer work, sometimes as much as 40, 50 hours a month that I volunteer, and that's when there's not an event. I just recently counted up how many I volunteered, 160 in the last month. So, but it's in priority. You make it a priority, and my daughter's on my schedule. They rescheduled something at the museum that I help, and I said, that's my daughter's day, and I make it a priority. It is much easier now since I am retired that I can go there more often.
Great.
Often someone who has limited resources or limited time can feel overwhelmed by those things, and they let that stop them from doing anything with their grandchildren. Do you have creative ideas or encouragement for people in those situations? Limited time or limited finances or resources?
Do you think I should start?
Yeah,
well, I have a church hat on. I taught art, elementary art, and have always been a little, you know, Jill and Cheryl back there in the old days, Jill gives me telephone wire and we make jewelry out of it. So I'm one of those that just whatever resource someone in the community gives me, then I find ways to use it. I'm a big looker at Pinterest these days. I come with the magazines back in the old days, but now I'm Pinterest. So my daughter, she told me when she had these kids, she's like, Mom, you got too much stuff at your house, I'll bring it to my house. So I'm just thinking, okay, now what can I do? Plus, I need to do it fast. You know, I live this really fast-paced life. I gotta do something. So I came up with this. This is my grandma's suitcase. It's my grandma's suitcase. And the things in the suitcase change. And, it doesn't have to be much of anything. Sometimes it's just the fact that you're sitting there with them doing it. So let's see. Somebody gave me this big piece of material. And earlier we were trying it out, and we made a little hammock. I make a little hammock under the table when I go to their house. I've got a piece of material. Plus you can use, just drape it over the chairs or whatever that, the tent city kind of thing. And then we had a cousin, she sent us sand from the beach. Do you know that 3-year-old, she will walk in the front door of my house and say, where's the sand? So it doesn't have to be like fancy things. It just has to be something a little different or special. You could do that with a water table or even just let them play in the dirt. Just clean them up before you give them back. Now, one of the things that I started doing is making boxes. Like this one is the city box. I thought about sending pictures, but I was a little bit concerned that I might spend too much time. If you are very interested in some of the things I do, I have a Facebook page, multiple ones. But what I do is I make a scene. This one is the city, and it has little houses, little people. And then underneath here is the construction paper, and I let the kid draw trees or whatever the scene is. Today, Charlotte was helping me, and we were trying to come up with a winter scene. So that this can change, it ebbs and flows depending on the age of the kid and what they are interested in at that time. So it's just not a fixed thing. And so I put different kind of items in the boxes, and then they go home with me, and Mom doesn't get upset with me. So this is just filled with, magnets, little pieces that Mom gets upset about leaving in the house. So the funniest thing is that there's some foam in here. There's a package. And this is when she was like 2 years old. She was begging me for this. We just drew a castle on there. And I cut it out. And then we had to take the cans out of the pantry and take them to it so they'd stand up. And so we made little castles and dragons. And they really don't matter what it looks like, as long as it looks a little bit something like it. The kids love it. So this is why, it doesn't have to be much. Go, does anybody still have a hat or something that they can play with or dress up with or, wear my necklace? Because I have grandkids that don't see me very often. They don't know me. And so when they first get into learning who I am, I wear necklaces so that they'll come to me. I've seen me that way. But they'll come to me, and then I let them play with my necklaces, and Mom doesn't want to play with hers. So I guess I better rush.
Okay, let me give you some ideas. My wife has come up with almost all these ideas. But, there's a train that goes through Lee Summit, and you can get on the train, ride it downtown Kansas City, get off at Union Station, get onto the streetcar, ride the streetcar up and down, eat dinner. Now, the problem is you haven't got a way home. So I have a son who works downtown. So we do that, and you get down there, he gets off work an hour early, and he can bring him home. But usually we have 2 carloads, so my wife gets on the train with the kids, with the daughter-in-laws, and they ride, the kids ride the train downtown, and then I drive the car down, so I bring one load back in the car, and she brings my son brings another little bag. You know, we also have passes to the zoo. We take our kids to the zoo 3, 4, 5 times a year whenever it works out. Hopefully it's not 100 degrees like it has been lately. But, you know, things like that. You know, just something different. We have a, my one son's, his mother-in-law has a Camp Warmore for one weekend out of the year. She takes all her grandkids to their house and for the weekend. And so she has 4 grandkids at her house for the whole weekend, and she has things planned. But the kids look forward to that all summer long. They get to go to that camp for her and the things that they do, and they'll camp out in the backyard, they'll do whatever. But they, you know, there's things like that you can do to bring the kids to your house for special occasions or whatever. You know, we try and bring them to our house for Father's Day or Mother's Day or birthday parties or things like that. You know, if you got kids who are out of town, learn how to text. If you don't text, you better learn how to text or you won't be able to communicate with them. You know, it's just part of life, isn't it? You know, they won't answer the phone. They'll answer your text and text with you all day long. You know, and the young ones, you know, it's starting at 7, 8, 10, 12 years of age that they have phones and are capable of texting and video chat, you know, whatever. They can do all those sort of things. So, you know, if you can't communicate with them because they're 2 hours away or 6 hours away or whatever, we haven't got that problem. But if you've got that problem, that's, you know, one of the things that you can help to kind of alleviate a little bit of that, you know. So you got to be sometimes inventive with what you can think of ways you can get a hold of them, talk to them, and communicate with them. But it doesn't take a whole lot of thinking out of the box, just a little bit. And so when the wife comes up with another crazy idea, what have I got to do this time? You know, but there's ways that you can, you know, get with your grandkids and go do things with them. You know, obviously you go to their soccer games, you go to their basketball games, you go to their ballet, whatever it is, school programs. You know, you get involved in those things, you show up at them. I mean, we have, you know, one grandkid that is, you know, not my son's, but it's from a previous marriage, and so we go to her stuff too. You know, she's part of the family now. We make her part of the family. Obviously, she doesn't always make it to everything, but when she's there, we include her just as much as all the rest of them. And when we go to her basketball games or her school play and pick her up from school as needed, when necessary, just like we do the rest of them. She's in a part of the family. And so you've got to do those things for the extra ones. And so before I forget one story, I want to tell you a good one, and I have too many stories that we could be here for 4 or 5 hours. Chuck doesn't have any stories. Okay, Chuck, so here we go. This is close on this one. So we got this one granddaughter by the name of Zoe, and her speech is not just perfectly crispy clear. And a couple of years ago, they go to different grandparents all the time, and they got to have a way to recognize what grandparents' house they're talking about. So what does Zoe say she's going to?
Grandma and Grandpa with a horse.
No. I'm going to Grandma and Grandpa's house with a horse house. Well, that was horse, not whore. Horse. And we got embarrassed several times in front of people when that came out. She would say that, and it wouldn't come out just real plain.
I feel like that could have been one of our questions.
But those kids, you know, they had nicknames for us, and so but they had nicknames for the different grandparents, so they could keep track of us and figure out who was who.
Well, Jim, you really touched on our next question already, so it's a perfect segue. Speak to someone who has multiple grandchildren and feels pressure to spread their time and energy evenly to all of them. Is that even possible? And how can you encourage someone?
That's probably you.
Well, I've already kind of covered what I have done. I never really felt pressure to do that because our family does get together a lot. And as the kids have all grown up, and you know, now we've got great grandkids too. But in our family gatherings, we love to play games. And that's another thing that I did with the grandkids when I was just with them. We love playing games. And in the earlier years, we didn't have all the video stuff. I'm old fashioned, and I still believe that communication with board games and that kind of things is so valuable. once again, you know, I plan and I keep a calendar, and when there's something going on, I tell them, you better let me know, you know, what's going on, because if it's not on my calendar, I won't be there because there's always something else that it can be done. And I just don't feel the need to be competitive with everybody, and my kids don't make me feel that way, and so I'm blessed in that way.
Well, I don't have very many grandkids, so it doesn't.
Yep. Okay, that's fine. To the grandparent who has out of town grandchildren, Sarah's might be you, or someone who does not have biological grandchildren, what are some ways that you can find opportunities to get involved in children and youth's lives today locally? And I think all of you, besides your grandchildren, are involved in some way investing in either in the church or outside in the community. So probably all of you could speak a little bit to that.
One thing that I've done through the years, I've done it for probably, you'll see, how old are you, Holly?
I'm 33. So.
33? So I've probably done it for 33 years. Because Holly and my daughter are the same age. But I find people within my church that maybe their child was close to me. And I guess it's always, well, it hasn't always been girls, because sometimes it was the boys when my son was younger. But I involve them in whatever it is I'm doing. You know, I have the lack of family around. And sometimes it's lonely, but you find ways to make family within the church, to make family within your neighborhood. I was telling Carol, like, one of the loneliest times I ever had in my life was the night my husband was ordained as a deacon, because it was just me and my daughter. We were too far away. No one else could come, especially on a Sunday night. And so you have to look at it a little differently, and all of that. So what I did is reach out to these people in the community. Holly used to come over and help me. I do art and crafts. I've done it for all these years, and I do work. I call them workshops. I even teach for the Continent Public Library. I teach workshops for their system too. And so I've always got some art and crafts sitting around that needs, you know, you need to cut out this, cut out that. And so I just bring the kids in to help me. And Holly helped me. I was producing a newsletter back in that day, an art newsletter that I mailed out. And so she and my daughter, one day they got loose with the flour. they got a little tired, and they threw flour at each other on the driveway. But what fun memories it was. I mean, we still had so much fun together along working. And now Holly's daughter's working for me. So she's worked today, in fact, and helped me with my next workshops so that I'm preparing, because I work out in the community with these workshops. And then I've also learned that that's a way to mentor. If your children, grandchildren, see other Christian people, they might not be exactly like me. But if they're a Christian and their life looks different, a different career, Cheryl likes to quilt, other people have different hobbies, you know, who knows what that grandchild likes. Are those people like? And if they can see Christ in other people in their community, it gives them a stronger base for dealing with whatever happens to them later and staying closer to the faith, I think. We had many conversations. Here's what I was worried about Holly. She was so sure she was just into witnessing. She was going to go down to that. You know, here she is like 13, 14 years old. She was going to go to the bar downtown when she got to be like 19. And she was going to witness to those hardcore people. And I was like, oh, I'm scared of the other. And she actually might try it, and something might happen to her along the way. But that's what she used to tell me she was going to do. So
I will add that I did end up doing that because I was a bartender for 13 years. So witnessing. But that was a really unique time. And I will add to Sarah's, which is not really my job here, that Sarah has an easy in because she does do the newsletters, but there were plenty of times where we were just keeping up on household chores or gardening, and so anybody really could find something.
You know what, I remember, this is one thing I told Charlotte the other day, Holly didn't know how to wash beans and soak them before you cook them. She thought they just came out of a can. Because <That's right. laughs> her mom always did it that way.
So you can really teach them anyway.
Yes, yes.
Do we want to add any more to that? I don't want to skip past you, but we'll go on to the next question. Okay. So are there any fears or obstacles that you've had to overcome in connecting with children and youth, and how have you overcome that?
When you get the kids for long term, you know, like a day, sooner or later there's a discipline issue that comes up. So how do you mix that and make it match with mom and dad's discipline or whatever? And we kind of make it, it's our house, it's our rules, go sit in the corner, you know. So, you know, but we don't have any major problems, or haven't had any major problems, but it's been, you know, there's always minor issues, especially with some of the younger kids. And, you know, we just let them know at our house they're going to follow our rules.
Any others to add to that?
No, we did have some foster children at one time. That was a real foster grandchildren, and that was a real, it's really hard because you're bringing these, they were sexually abused girls. And so you're bringing them into your house with your family, and you had to really watch the other children around because you didn't know what they would do, or you didn't know one of the girls had like thrown things at a TV and broken it, and so you were very much on guard. That was what I remember, when you have situations like that where there's a child with problems, it puts a little different slant on it. So I did a lot of praying during that time that, you know, you would do what's right for those children.
Okay, so it sounds like prayer is going to be key, and if there's obstacles,
always.
So, yeah,
to always.
All right. What has been the most rewarding thing that you've discovered from connecting with grandchildren or just children from younger generations?
What do you got? You haven't talked, it's your turn.
Well, our younger son does not go to church. He grew up in church, but no longer goes to church. So we try to get his kids. Those are the ones we watch the most, and we try to bring them to church with us whenever we can. And just what's fulfilling to me is when we see where they've learned something, we didn't think they were really paying attention that much, and sometimes just getting the joy, like the musical that they're doing, the joy they get from practicing the music and singing. So it's just fulfilling to see that it's sinking in. You know, we may not be thinking that it is that much, but it's getting through.
Go ahead. I'll just add one thing to that and kind of put a plug in for our Awana program. I have worked with the Awana program ever since we've had it here, and I think that's been 9 or 10 years. And, of course, as I mentioned before, I've been here for a long time, worked in the nursery. I've seen our children grow up, many, many of them. Now they're taller than me, and they love to stand and look down at me. but they give me hugs, too. And but to watch the children learn and be able to understand the scriptures that they are learning, and that's part of my job as a listener. I try to make sure that they're not just saying words, that they understand what they're saying. And that has just been a joy in my heart to do that. And I had another thought. When you get old, they leak out. but it is, it's just the fact that this church, and I'm talking about the Gathering Church, I think that we are all very kid-oriented, and we want to see them grow in their faith because they've got a tough world out there. And if they have that ingrained in them, it's going to make it easier. And I remembered what I was going to say. They put a trust in you, and that's one reason that I have stayed doing this all these years. I was thinking about not doing it this year, and I've had two kids come up to me, are you going to be a listener this year? And of course, I'm going to be a listener this year. And Elizabeth Smith, she clapped her hands and she said, oh, goody, goody, goody. And, you know, just the fact they recognize you and know that you care about them. that is huge. And then we have a lot of kids that don't even go to church regularly, but they make a connection, mm-hmm. and I just think that's so important.
Well, I think they bring excitement to me. That's you know, that's the most important thing. The reward I get when they're growing in the faith, of course, that exceeds all as you watch them grow up in the Lord. But what Charlotte did in me today is I worked hard after she left, because she left her excitement with me. I miss not having kids around. But when I work with these kids and I help them, and sometimes we play together, sometimes we make crazy videos together, it just leaves me excited enough to go on, because I live with an 88-year-old father, and my husband's the same age as me, and my 40-year-old son. So there's just guys everywhere I look. So it's nice to have a little companionship with children.
Well, you all really did talk on our next question already, but I don't want to skip it. The Bible has a lot to say about one generation passing on God's teaching and faithfulness to another generation. So why would you say that this is important in our church and in our world? And why is it about more than just the nuclear family shouldering that responsibility?
Well, I think it's good for the kids to see that all different ages still work for the Lord and serve with children. They need to see that, so they don't grow up and think, well, I get to a certain age, I don't serve that way anymore. Sorry. And it, like you say, it does help you stay young, mm-hmm. working with them. We worked with Awana when it was at Plaza, and we worked with our school next door. Mm-hmm. Can't think of the name of the program that we do over there. It's left me.
Good News Club.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
She didn't know where our food pantry was. So she had to Google food pantry.
That church, but he wants us to serve, and we need to show the kids that it can be fun to do that, no matter what your age.
I probably already said enough about it.
And I did. Okay. I sort of included in that mm-hmm. other.
Yeah, you did.
Question.
Sure.
Okay, how do you work through the feeling, the need or the pressure to be the fun one all the time? And maybe that's in comparison to other grandparents you see, maybe friends, or the child's other grandparents.
That's real simple. You know Granny, come on, Papa's
here. You know, I don't worry about being the fun one. I just live life to the fullest anytime I can. I realize I'm a little bit different kind of personality on that. But what I worry about more than that, and I pray a lot about this, I pray about for the other grandmother. The other grandmother has an adult child at her house that had a baby out of wedlock. And her husband is a truck driver. And she takes care of that grandchild all the time. So my granddaughters don't ever get their other grandmother by themselves, you know, with their nuclear family and grandma with them. They always have to share. And I know that, I'm the mother of the daughter. So you know how that kind of changes, you know, I can do things that the other grandmother doesn't get to do sometimes, because of the nature of that. And I worry about her, and I pray for her that God will be fulfilled. You know, she will have that fulfilled feeling as a grandmother, and that she won't look at that, and that she'll know I'm a teacher and a crazy, off-the-wall kind of person that just likes to have fun anywhere I go. I read something a long time ago, because most of you don't know me in this room, and it said we need to do what we like to do as long as it's right with God. And so I want to live life to the fullest, you know, with all my crazy antics, off the wall. I want other people to go, wow, she has a lot of fun being a Christian. You know, I don't want them to say, oh, the Christian life is just so sad. You just can't do this and you can't do that. How many times have I been told, you can't do this, you can't do that, you can't do something else. It's like, I'm going to live so full. You know, I'm going to wear my crazy hat. I wear a lot of hats and do things like that. But I worry about the other people, and I also want to pray for those other grandparents.
You got to be yourself, whatever that is.
That's
you know, you can't compete with that other grandparent who may have some other situation that you think the kids love and think is great. You know, we've got something as simple as a little porcelain turtle that sits in my landscaping out front. That is a fun thing for my youngest boy. How old's Ben? Ben's four. And every time he comes, he looks to where the turtle is. Because every time he leaves, I move it.
No, that's funny.
So Ben comes, where's the turtle hiding this time? You know, well, during the summer, it's pretty easy to hide him amongst the plants. In the wintertime, it gets a little more challenging, you know, to hide the turtle or something. A little landscape mulch or something over him or just what you do. But, you know, something just as simple as that. You can do something that the kid kind of looks forward to. Where's the turtle hidden? So, you know, just a simple thing. You've got to come up with your own ideas of what you're going to do, but you can do something that you can connect with each of those kids, you know, in some way, shape, or form. The older they get, the harder it is to stay connected with them. When they become teenagers, good luck. but you got to do something to stay connected with them and do something with them or for them. And that's why you go to their plays, their basketball games, and their things. Is, you know, if they're in town, or you can do that, you do those things. You know, if they're 2, 3, 4 hours away, you got to find out when they're playing a basketball game, and you call up after they're home and say, how'd the basketball game go, or how did the play go, or whatever. You know, there's ways you can stay connected with them, but you got to work at it. Yeah. You know, you got to get your calendar and write down what they've got going on, and then you got to figure out, you know, what you're going to do. And then there's the trouble when one grandparent says, oh, yeah, we'll pick your kids up at such and such a time. And the other one talks to the other grandparents, son, and says, yeah, we'll pick your kids up. And now you got two different directions you're going. That happens. You just got to work it out with your kids and see what you can do to work through those things. Sometimes, you know, everybody gets busy and things overlap. And you got to figure out where you're going to be and who you're going to be with. You know,
those holidays.
Yeah, holidays. Oh, yeah. Good luck with that Thanksgiving and Christmas and where are the kids going to eat dinner? Any of you grandmas out there got upset because you couldn't get that arranged just the perfect time you wanted to have Thanksgiving dinner or Christmas dinner?
That is the benefit of not having them in town. I will tell you that. You might have to eat by yourself with your spouse or with, you know, some other friends, but we just do that. We, you know, there's an every other plan in our life, and my daughter had a little trouble getting the son-in-law's family on board, but now they're on board, and they just know, you know. Every other year, they're at my house for Christmas. Every other year, they're at my house for Thanksgiving. So, you know, just have them for one. Sure, it's easier than running around 5 or 6 places in one.
Mary, did you have anything to add to that one?
I don't really have that issue because I am the only grandparent to my grandchildren. Now, my great-grandchildren, it's very complicated. But, you know, they were able to work it out. And it's not really been a problem.
Good.
Okay. Well, we do have one other question on discipline, but because I'd like to make sure we save time for question and answer, and we touched on that, I'm going to go down to our last question, which is, how do you love and accept your grandchildren or just younger generations as you watch them make choices you do not support?
Since I am the grandmother of grandchildren in their 20s and 30s, I have experienced this in my grandchildren's lives. And I talk with them and I tell them what I believe and what I think. And, you know, you can't change them, but they've always respected me and allowed me to speak to them. My oldest grandson, and most of you in this room know me, know that, told me about 6 years ago that he is gay and brought a male spouse into our family, which was one of the hardest things that you can imagine. I never stopped loving him, and I mean, the Holy Spirit gave me words that just I could not have said on my own. But it broke my heart, of course. He's the brilliant one in the family. He's the engineer, you know. Went to the good schools where they don't teach anything except not believing. And so anyway, we're fine. Our family is still intact, and we do things together, and I love him with all my heart. He's my first grandchild. And I love his partner. He is a neat kid, just a wonderful guy. But this is something that I never envisioned. I was certainly not the best person in the world as I grew up, and I made some poor choices, nothing to that degree, but I know I disappointed my parents in many ways, and my grandparents, and God brought me home, and he never gives up, and that is my prayer, that with each one of my grandchildren, and I have a couple of others that I kind of like to turn over my knee sometime, but you love them. They're the same always as far as my relationship with them. And I am blessed to have every one of them, and I pray for them all that God will bring them home, because he is faithful, and I know he has a plan, and I tell them that. And I said, I never give up, and I tell them I will never give up, and neither will God.
That's great. Thank you for that.
I think you said it. You realized it. Yeah.
Okay, if you'll allow me, I'm just going to stop our recording.